Welcome to LINAK's Actuator Academy video series for industrial actuators. I'm Hunter, and today we're going to talk about an IO actuator's adjust movement features. One of several options configurable from within Actuator Connect configurator for LINAK's IO interface. We know that traditionally an actuator's task is to run in and out at a default speed, but there's an increasing demand for advanced features and more control options. With the adjust movement features in Actuator Connect, you can get more flexibility out of LINAK's IO actuators with various control options, virtual limits, and adjustable speed, allowing you to be completely in control of your linear movement behavior. But before we dive more into the details about the different control options and speed settings you get, let's look at the IO actuator's wiring diagram in Actuator Connect. From this home menu in Actuator Connect, the wiring diagram tab allows you to see the actual wiring diagram of the connected actuator. This is important because the IO actuator offers various input and output wiring options, which gives many opportunities when controlling and adjusting the actuator. The functionality of these inputs and outputs can be customized directly in Actuator Connect, and the wiring diagram will continuously be updated. Some of the wires are reserved for a specific functionality and therefore cannot be changed, but a total of 6 wires can be customized and are relevant to the adjust movement option. The red and black wires are used for driving the actuator, where 4 different control options can be selected. The orange and light blue wires can also be used for moving the actuator to specific positions. All of these input options can be divided into either digital or analog control signals. The digital input detects if a voltage is above or below a specific threshold. If the voltage is higher than 2/3 of 24 volts or 48 volts, the supply voltage, the actuator will detect the digital input as high. If the voltage is lower than 1/3 of the supply voltage, the actuator will detect the input as low. By default, the actuator will only run on a high signal. The actuator can also be controlled with an analog signal. In this case, the input is variable and not just simply on or off. The analog input signal can be used to control either position or speed, which we'll explain later in this video as servo and proportional control. Now with the basics of our flexible input options out of the way, let's look at the actual features offered within the adjust movement option. As you can see on the screen, you get different control options to choose from. Here's a quick explanation. Let's start with the standard run. Controlling an IO actuator is based on an integrated controller or H-bridge that switches the polarity of the voltage to the DC motor. Here you can benefit from low current switching, since a high digital signal of only a few milliamps will cause the actuator to run. The H-bridge is explained in detail in our Academy video about PCBs, but this graphic will help you understand the basics. The integrated H-bridge opens a variety of control options from the PCB, such as speed and ramping. This is the H-bridge, and in the middle is a power connection to the motor's plus and minus terminals. 4 switches, in this case transistors, are connected to the power supply at the top and bottom of the H-bridge. These transistors replace the functionality of mechanical relays. The H-bridge controls the in and out movement of the actuator in a fairly simple way. When the power is on, 2 of the transistors must be activated to make the current flow diagonally past the motor connection, making the motor run in one direction. For standard run, the red wire is used to move the actuator in the outwards direction, and the black wire is used for the inwards direction. As you can see in Actuator Connect, it's possible to set the same speed in both directions or a specific speed for each direction. For instance, drive in at 50% speed, but drive out at 100% speed, like so. That's 100% speed, and in at 50% speed. Under predefined positions, you can select up to 2 target positions. This is useful if you want to move to the exact same position every time. This can, for instance, be controlled by push buttons, 1 for each position, or as a command on your PLC. The digital input signal must remain high until the target position has been reached, but it will not move beyond that point. In the example shown here, you can see that target position 1 is running to 150 millimeters and target position 2 is running fully in. Both positions are controlled by the push buttons. By using the orange and light blue wires as digital inputs, it's possible to have 4 control options for the actuator: red and black for standard run, and orange and light blue for target positions. Each of these 4 input wires can have individual speed settings for maximum flexibility. If the actuator experiences a position lost error, the orange and light blue wires used for predefined positions can no longer be used to drive the actuator. Because of this, the red and black wires are reserved for standard run so that the actuator can be reinitialized. For impulse run, either one or two wires are used to move the actuator. Impulse run is when a high signal is sent once but not held to request actuator movement to a specified point. If you choose impulse run on one wire, the actuator can run in both directions by giving a signal on this wire. As an additional feature, you can see that it's also possible to set the button hold time. Let's look at an application where impulse run is commonly used. Here's a garage door where the actuator is operated by a push button. Press once to drive it out, press once more to stop it, and press once again to drive it in. In this case, we use only the red wire for impulse run, and you have multiple options to choose from for the black wire. Another option is to dedicate the red wire for running outwards and the black wire for running inwards. Using this option, you'll be able to control direction using either wire and stop by simply sending the momentary signal again. With servo drive, you can use an analog input signal to control the position of the actuator. This way, the physical stroke length of the actuator is scaled according to the input signal, thereby offering full control of the actuator positioning with a signal of your own choice. As mentioned previously, these analog input signals can be 4 to 20 milliamps, 0 to 10 volts, or 0 to 100% PWM. Let's take an example of a 300 millimeter actuator with 4 to 20 milliamps servo control. You can run this actuator between 4.5 milliamps to 19.5 milliamps, equal to the stroke length of the actuator. There are two outer limits, which ensures that the actuator stops if the signal becomes too low. Could be a disconnected cable, or too high if the conductor is short-circuited to the VCC. This is visualized in the illustration here. Running to 75 millimeters or 25% of the stroke length on this actuator would require an input signal of 8.25 milliamps. So servo is a signal that determines where specifically the actuator should be positioned, something that is particularly useful if you have an application that requires running to multiple different positions. This is a common control concept in, among other things, industrial automation. Proportional control is like servo, but instead of controlling the position, you can control the speed and direction of the actuator based on your analog input. You can choose between single or dual control input, depending on your preferences. For single control input, the actuator moves in both directions from one signal as shown here. The illustration gives a good idea of what that looks like. At 50%, nothing happens, but over 50%, you move outwards, and under 50%, you move inwards. There's a dead band on both sides, stopping in and stopping out. The actuator runs faster and slower depending on what input you provide. This input is applied to the red wire. In this case, the black wire is either not in use for PWM or used as a ground for the analog input, current or voltage. For dual control input, two wires are used to run the actuator inwards or outwards. The principle is like the single control input, but there's a larger area to control the speed, which allows more fine tuning of the speed. The dual control input has one wire for each direction and is PWM only. A very common example of proportional control is a joystick. The further you push forward, the faster the actuator runs. A joystick like this will have a neutral point, and it'll be possible to run the actuator in both directions depending on whether the joystick is pushed forwards or backwards. Virtual limits can be used to stop the actuator before it reaches the physical end stop in both directions. This can either be preset from the factory or configured in Actuator Connect. This is particularly useful if you're trying to use the actuator for prototyping or have multiple actuators in stock that you'd like to adapt to various fits in the application. It can also be convenient for applications where the stroke length occasionally needs to be adjusted. These virtual limits can be set manually if the stroke limitation is known in advance or automatically using learn mode. For manual, set a value in millimeters in one or both directions. You'll want to make sure these points are outside of the mid-stroke initialization zone of 35 to 70 millimeters. Here I've set the virtual limit out to 100 millimeters and into 20 millimeters, which means that the actuator will only ever run between 20 and 100 millimeters. So we'll run out and it'll stop at 100 millimeters. And when we go to run in, it'll stop at 20. Learn mode allows the actuator to learn a new end stop. It does this based on predefined zones along the stroke length and a current limit to trigger the new end stop, like an obstruction. In some cases, it might be a good idea to add a step back after meeting an obstruction. This allows you to learn a new end stop slightly away from the mechanical block, which will potentially extend the service life of the actuator and provide smoother movement. It's also possible to specify a speed setting for when the actuator is running in learn mode, in case you'd like to run slower when learning an obstruction. Learn mode can be performed directly in the Actuator Connect or by shorting the red and black wires in a sequence that looks like this. The ability to initiate learn mode with the wires allows you to easily start this process directly in your application, even multiple times throughout the actuator's life. It will always keep the zone settings you specified when the actuator was ordered or an Actuator Connect, and use those to set the new virtual limits. We hope you enjoyed this introduction to the adjust movement features within Actuator Connect, and that you can use this knowledge to think outside the box when designing future applications. If you have any questions about the LINAK I/O actuators or the options that come with them, feel free to contact your local LINAK office. Thanks for watching.